Welcome to another tutorial of ProfLearn YouTube channel. In this particular video, we're going to have a discussion on how to work out questions involving the topics materials. So we're going to look at strain, stress, and Young's modulus. We shall have a detailed discussion on what are the key areas that you must focus as far as your A-level AS mechanical materials unit 1 exam is concerned. If you are new to ProfLearn YouTube channel, consider subscribing so that any time we're going to upload another tutorial, you'll be notified. Now we need to begin and look at the first question, whereby we are told a steadily increasing tensile force was applied to a sample of titanium alloy. The sample had the original length of 4 centimeters and diameter of 5.05 millimeters. And we are supposed to state the suitable instrument to measure the diameter of a sample. Remember, the choice of an instrument depends on the nature of the measurement that has to be taken. Now, for instance, if you want to measure thickness of a sheet of paper, thickness of a thin wire, thickness of a thread, thickness of hair, you can use a micrometer screw gauge. And you need also to know which instruments should be used to measure maybe the inner radius of a measuring cylinder. That one is a vernier calipers. So this one we're going to use a micrometer screw gauge. Now, the graph shows stress varies with strain, for example, where you're going to meet various questions which involve that. And you need to understand when a graph is drawn stress against strain, you are going to have a section where it's a straight line. So in that straight line, it means that in this region where it's a straight line, it means that stress is directly proportional to strain. And you can be able to use this straight line region in order to work out the value of the Young's modulus of the material that was used to come up with the graph. Now let us see into and determine the Young's modulus of the sample. You are given, if you be given in your exam a graph and then you are supposed to work out the Young's modulus, you are going to work out the gradient of the section where the graph is straight. You need to find the gradient of the straight line graph section when you are told to work out the Young's modulus. So we are going to work out the gradient in the section whereby we are going to draw a right angle triangle, then we find rise and run. So our rise is actually 800 times 10 raised to power 6, and run, we can be able to understand the scale that is used here, and then we can be able now to work out the gradient. So working out the gradient, we are going to get a value equivalent to what? Let us see what we are getting. We can be able to use our calculator. And then our value becomes, let me see, 1.2 times 10 raised to power 11 pascals. Remember, the units for Young's modulus is pascals, because you are dividing stress divided by strain. The unit for stress is pascals or Newton per meter square. But strain has no units. So that is why we are saying the Young's modulus has got the units pascals. Pascals just like pressure. Right. Now, something else that you need to remember is that Young's modulus tells you how stiff a material is. Those materials which are quite stiff, which are very stiff, they have a large Young's modulus, meaning that it will be very difficult for you to bend such kind of materials. Metals have a large Young's modulus than materials which easily bend, so that's quite important. And this is a property of material which is used by engineers in order to know whether a material that is used or a metal that is used in a given building is able to withstand different forces. We need to move down and determine the force required to break the sample. We can see the information provided. We have the Young's modulus. So now at B is the breaking point. Yeah, B is the maximum force that can be applied in order to break this object. Then we can be able to check what is the stress at point P, the stress which corresponds to B. Then now, once we have that stress, we can be able to use the concept of stress, having the fact that stress is equal to force over the cross-section area. So the stress in this case is 1290 times 10 raised to power 6 pascals. And then we can be able to go now down here and say stress equals to force over area. Right? So we can be able to check here. We have the original length and we have the diameter. Now this diameter that we have, which is 5.05 millimeters, can be converted to meters. And then it's going to enable us to work out the area, and which is the cross-section area, because when you are working out pressure, you need to know what the cross-section area is. So we're going to use 5.05 millimeters. We work out the cross-section area. So diameter is given in millimeters. Then we can be able to convert this by multiplying by 10 raised to the power negative 3, and that becomes now in meters. Then once we have that, we can be able to find the area of the cross-section of that the cross-section area of that wire, of that sample. Then we can be able to use the formula pi r squared. Then we will have to divide by 2 so that the diameter can be converted to radius. So working out this, we are going to get what? Let's use our calculator here. -5 meters square, which will mean that we can now use this area we have gotten together with the stress that is here. We can now be able to work out the force required to break this sample. Then we can now say force equals to stress times cross-section area, because we can, if you rearrange that, force will be equal to stress times cross-section area, meaning that we can now multiply that cross-section area together with the stress. Then we can get our force being equal to 2580 newtons. Our force becomes 2.58 times 10 raised to power 4 newtons. And that is exactly what we are going to write down here, just to make the examiner happy. If you are new to ProfLearn YouTube channel, consider subscribing so that any time we are going to upload another tutorial, you'll be notified. Moving down, the graph shows a linear section of a stress strain graph for the sample, and then we are told that show that the area under the graph represents the work done per unit volume of the stretching object. Now first we know that area of this is actually a half base times height, so we can be able to say now area is equals to a half base times height, but our base is going to be the strain and our height is going to be the stress. Yeah. So writing this in the strain, we know strain is calculated by the formula extension over the original length. Yeah, I can be able to write that epsilon times sigma. Of course, those are the symbols for strain and stress, but we know that strain is extension of original length, and sigma, which is stress, is force over area. If you multiply E times F, just work done is equal to E a half EF. Remember, work done in a spring is a half times extension times the force applied This is the section for work done. And then we know that length times cross-section area gives us volume. Then you can be able to say, therefore, area is equals to work done of volume like that. So this is just a proof that the area represents the work done per unit volume. Now, working at Roman 4, we are told that the area under N stress strain graph represents the work done per unit volume. Estimate the amount of work required to break the titanium alloy sample. So, meaning that we can now go back and work out the area of one square. We need to work out the area of one square so that once we know the area of one square, we can go ahead and work out the area under that graph so that we can be able to find the area under the graph. Then we shall now say that that area is equivalent to the work done per unit volume. So using the scale, at the area of this big square is actually going to be 100 times 10 to the power 6 times 0.005. And then if you work it out, you're going to get 5.0 times 10 raised to the power 5. Then once you have the area of one square, you can now go back to this. Because the breaking point is at B, so we're going to work out the area under the graph from the beginning to where B is. So we're going to use counting the square. We count all the... In order to work out this, we're going to count all the complete squares under the graph and then count those incomplete squares. Now to work out the area under the graph using estimation of squares, we usually say is the number of complete squares plus a half of the number of the incomplete. Then now once we have done that, we are going to multiply each of the incomplete, and this now will give us incomplete squares. We count all incomplete squares. Then now we shall add the number you have for all the incomplete squares times a half, and you add the squares. Then from there you shall now say this is, of course, I've counted the complete squares are 102, incomplete squares are 33, then that 3 divided by 2. Then we add now the answer we get. Now I've gotten now the area and the number of squares below the graph is 118.5, then times the area of one square, which is going to be what? Let us work it out using a calculator and see what we are going to get. (5.925 × 10⁻⁷) joules per meter cubic. Now we have the area under the graph, but we know we need to work out the, let's see, we have the length and we have the cross section area. Then we can be able to work out the volume. Volume is cross section area times length, which we are going to substitute the values we have, and remember also to convert the units to meters. So the volume is 8.01 × 10⁻⁶, but area now is equals to work done over volume. Then to work, to calculate work done, it will be volume times area, which means that we are going to take area, which is (5.925 × 10⁻⁷) times now the volume, which is 8.01 × 10⁻⁶. Working out this, we're going to get our value as this 4 point. We're going to get for 74.6 joules, which is 4.7 times 10 raised power 2 joules. Now this is the work done to ensure that titanium alloy sample is broken. In question 2, the diagram shows a climber on a rock face. A rope is kept firmly anchored by a person on the ground and passes through a smooth loop over the climber. The climber slips and falls a short distance as shown. Yeah. The fall factor is used by climbers to estimate the severity of a climbing fall and is given by fall factor equals to height fallen before the rope begin to stretch over the total and stretch length of the of the rope. A climber slips and fall through a fall factor of 0.8 before coming to rest. Then we are told that the maximum strain in the rope is 9.0%. We are told that the maximum strain in the rope is 9.0%. Remember, strain is strain doesn't have units, so it can also be expressed as a percentage. Strain has no unit, it can be expressed as a percentage. Show that the maximum force acting on the climber due to the rope is about 10 kilonewton. Assume the extension of the rope is proportional to its tension. Total and stretch length of the rope is 15 meters. Now the first thing we are going to do is to use the fall factor. And using the fall factor, we can be able to work out the height fallen by the climber in the process of that. So we have the unstretched length is 15, so we can be able to use the factor to get the height that climber is going to fall through. Now working out that, we are going to get the height is 12 meters. Now number two, we need to go down here. We know that strain is equals to extension divided by the original length, but we had said that strain has no units, and it also, because it's a ratio between two lengths, it can be also expressed as a percentage. So we can be able to use that information in order to work out the extension. So we can say 15 times 9 over 100, 9% of that. So that translates to 1.35 meters. And then we can now be able to say that gravitational potential energy, because once this person is going to fall to some height, there is a change in energy. So there is gravitational potential energy which can be obtained from the mass and the height fallen of 12 meters, and we can get that to be equivalent to 8,358.12 joules. But there is also potential energy due to the extension of this rope, and this is going to be what? This is a mass times gravity times the height, the length fallen, which is 1.35. So from the fall GPE due to the extension also is going to be that. And remember now, these two gravitational potential energies will be added together, and that energy, now we have gravitational potential energy, is going to be transferred into the stretching rope, and that remembering that the climber was at this given point, then immediately this person slips is going to fall through a given height. So meaning gravitational potential energy will be converted to elastic potential energy in the rope. So that's why we're saying that in that process, in order to work out, because we're supposed to show that the maximum force acting on the climber during the rope is 10 kilonewtons. Is approximately 10 kilonewtons. So, which means that we can work out the potential energy due to the falling height of 12 meters. And also we work out the potential energy due to the extension of the rope of 1.35 meters. Then we add the two. But we shall now say that energy is equivalent to a half force times extension, right? So meaning that we're going to work out this value of F, and which is going to be approximately 13.7 kilonewtons. This is kilonewtons, which is approximately 10 kilonewtons. Gravitational potential energy, the concept used here is that gravitational potential energy would be converted to elastic potential energy. Explain how the work done to break the new cable is different from the work done to break the original cable. Now, replacing the original cable with a lower Young's modulus, it means the new cable is more elastic. This means it will stretch. Let me just write this properly here. It will stretch more under the same stress, under the same stress compared to the original cable. The two cables have the same breaking stress. That information was given. Then the new cable has a greater diameter. Since the new cable has the greater diameter, this results to a large cross section area. And then we can now say this allows the cable to withstand a large force before breaking. So the work done to break the new cable is greater than the work done to break the original cable. Climbing rope manufacturers recommend that ropes are replaced every 5 years. The force extension graphs up to the breaking point for a 1 meter length of a rope when new and after 5 years are shown. Then we have the graphs here. We are supposed to comment the manufacturer's recommendation. You can also we are going to include calculations involving in order to explain this, we are going to use calculations. Your answer should include calculations. So we know that area under the graph, force against extension, gives the energy or the amount of elastic potential energy stored in that material. So meaning in order to show this, we are going to work out the area under the graph for the rope when new, and also for the rope when after 5 years. Then we see which one has more energy, which one can be able to store more elastic energy. So if a material stores less elastic energy before breaking, then it's going to be what? It's going to be dangerous, because that rope or that material is going to snap or break immediately a small amount of energy, a small amount of stretching force has been applied. So in this case, we're going to say that area under a graph represents the elastic potential energy that is stored in that material. So meaning that for the new rope, you are going to count the number of squares below the graph, and then find the area of one square, count all the squares, and then find the area of one square, then multiply by that in order to work out the area under the graph. So we can be able to subdivide this and then count the number of squares. So first, let's find the area of one big square. So if you work out the area of one square, you can see now that is 2,500 by 0.025. Then the area is going to translate to what? The area becomes 62.5 joules. So then now we're going to count the number of squares below the new rope. Once you get the number of squares, then you can be able to multiply by the energy stored by one square, which is 62.5. You do the same for the rope after 5 years, and then you are going to realize that if you do the same, you are going to get different values. Energy stored in the new rope is going to be approximately 800. You are going to do that and check whether you're gonna get that. And energy stored in the old rope is approximately 700 joules. So you realize that the energy now stored in the new one is more than the old one. So meaning that if you apply a small amount of force on the old one, it's likely to break. So that is why the manufacturers were able to recommend that. So you have also to comment on that so that we can be able to say old rope is not stiff enough as stress, as stored energy is less, and this will break at a small applied force. In question number 3, when increasing force is applied, when an increasing force is applied to a steel cable, it will eventually reach its elastic limit. Now we are supposed to state what's meant by the term elastic limit. Remember, materials, when stretching force or when tensile force is applied on materials, they increase size. So as the size increases, it will reach a point whereby if you add a force that is beyond a given limit, the material will undergo plastic deformation, which means that the material cannot be able to regain the original size and shape upon removing of that stretching force. Now, elastic limit is the maximum force a material can withstand, beyond which that material undergoes plastic deformation or deforms permanently. So we can be able to say here that is a force, or is this is a force beyond which a cable does not return to its original length when the force or the stretching force is removed. Right? You can give different definition on this, but this is the simplest one. That is a force beyond which the cable does not return to its original length when the force is removed. We can also say is the force beyond which the cable undergoes plastic deformation. So which means that at this point also you need to understand what we mean elastic deformation. Elastic materials are materials which can increase in size and then go materials are said to be elastic because they can increase in size when a tensile force is applied, but they can regain their size, original size, when that tensile force is removed. So plastic deformation is a deformation where a material can regain its original shape once that force is removed. But plastic deformation is a deformation where the material cannot regain the original shape or size once that force is withdrawn. So you need to understand those terms. So there's another point also we're gonna mention about the proportional The elastic limit of steel cable was reached when a force of 13.4 times 10 raised to power 6 Newton was applied. The extension of the cable was 0.126 meters. Length of the cable is 6 meters. Cross-section area of the cable is 9.60 times 10 raised to power negative 3 square meter square. Calculate the strain and of the cable at its elastic limit. Strain is equal to extension over the original length. So meaning that we can be able to work out strain, which is going to be delta x, which is the extension over the original length. So we can be able to substitute the values here and then say our extension was 0.126 divided by the length, which is 6. Then working it out, we are going to get our value equivalent to 0.021. And remember, strain has no unit, it's dimensionless. So it has no units because it's a ratio between two lengths. So strain, you're going to realize sometimes can be given as a ratio, it can be expressed as decimals, but there are no units. And sometimes can be given as a percentage. So we can be able to say our strain is 0.021. We're supposed to work out stress of the cable, and the stress actually is force of a cross-section area. And stress is the force that is developed within a material when tensile force is exerted. When you stretch a material, when you stretch, you apply a force to stretch a material, then the force which is internally developed to resist this force that you are trying to cause, you are trying to put in on the material, is called stress. So when you apply a force over a given area, then we have that particular value, that quantity we call what? Stress. And stress determines if materials can break. Yeah, some materials have withstand large amount of forces for them to break, and some materials can break within a given small force that's applied to it. Yeah, so let's see here. We can be able, first we are supposed to work out stress, and we have said stress is a force developed in a material when you try to stretch it or compress it, and this is going to be 13.4 times 10 raised to power 6 divided by the cross-section area, which was 9.6 times 10 raised to power negative 3. Working it out, we're going to get our answer being equivalent to what? Let's work it out to 1.396 times 10 raised to power 9 pascals, because this unit pascals just as the unit for pressure. But you see, for us to work out stress, we're dividing force and area. Force is in Newton and area is in meter square. So other units for stress are Newton per meter square, just like pressure. Okay. So that is it. We have our pressure calculated. We need to move to question number 4. We are told an engineer is designing a metal part of a machine, and the part is in the form of a cylindrical rod. The part is designed to behave elastically when compressive forces are applied. So you see now, if you apply compressive forces, the size of this rod is going to decrease, but that rod is going to exert external forces to try to resist the forces that are being, the compressive forces that are being exerted. But in part A, we are told to state what's meant by elastic deformation. We have mentioned in our previous discussion that elastic deformation is a deformation which occurs and a material can be able to regain the original size when that force is withdrawn or removed. So we have two types of deformation: plastic deformation, which is permanent. Once a material undergoes plastic deformation, it cannot regain its original size and shape. But for elastic deformation, a material regains its size once the tensile force is removed. So we need to write a precise definition of what is meant by elastic deformation, and we're going to say here that in elastic deformation, a material returns to its original size and shape when the stress or the tensile force is removed. That is basically what you are supposed to state in this question. Now, next, we are moving to part B, where we are told a compressive stress strain graph for one metal is shown here. We have on the y-axis we have stress, and on the x-axis we have strain. Then we are supposed to do what? Let's see, what are we expected to work out? Show that the Young's modulus for this metal is about 2 × 10⁻¹⁰ pascals. So basically, the examiner is trying to test whether you understand how to get the Young's modulus from a stress and a strain graphs. But since you've watched a tutorial from ProfLearn YouTube channel, you have been told that from stress strain graphs, for you to get the Young's modulus, you need to work out the gradient of the straight section of that particular graph. So we are going to say the gradient of the straight section of the stress strain graph is going to give us the Young's modulus. So we can say change in stress over change in strain is going to give us the Young's modulus. Then we're going now to go to our graph here. Then we can be able to identify a section here and try to see what's the reading down here and what the reading on the top here. If we go across, what will be the corresponding stress at this point? Then now we can now pick it and check. This is 44.45, and then we can also identify the strain down here so that we can be able to work out the gradient. The strain down here is 2.125, and then we can be able, don't forget there was × 10⁸ there. That is an area that you have to be very careful. And then we write this value × 10⁻³ and work out now your value using your calculator in order to see exactly what is expected of us, which translates to 2.09 × 10⁻¹. And you can see it's approximately this value that we were given at this given point. I believe that is okay. We can now move to the next question in Roman 2. And in Roman 2, we are told the metal part must not compress more than 0.6 millimeters when a force of 9.5 × 10⁵ is applied. That's the condition. Then we're supposed to deduce whether this metal is suitable for the part. Yeah. The metal length is 0.84 meters and the cross-section area is 4.8 times 10 raised power negative 3. Now, something that I need to mention here is that Young's modulus does not depend on the dimensions of the section of the material. Young's modulus is a property of a material. If you have a piece of metal from a given material and you get another piece of a different size from the same material, if you work out the Young's modulus, you're going to get the same value. So we can be able now to use the information provided here and check whether is the extension is the compression equivalent to zero. Is it more than 0.6 or is it less than 0.6? If it's more than 0.6 millimeters, then we're going to say that material is not suitable. That metal is not suitable for that part. So let us now begin. Let's begin working out this question. We know that force that was given here was 9.5 times 10 raised to power 5 Newton. Length was given as 0.84 meters. Cross-section area was given as 4.8 times 10 raised to power negative 3, right? We have Young's modulus, we had obtained it, so we are going to use the Young's modulus that we have gotten from the other previous section. We can say, let's use the Young's modulus that is there. 2.09 times 10 raised to power 11 pascals, and our objective is to find delta x. And this delta x that we shall find, which is the extension, we shall compare it with the 0.60 millimeters that we have somewhere there. So, stress can be obtained from the formula force over area. And we have the force, we have the cross-section area. Then we can be able to get the stress is equivalent to what? Let's see. 1.98 times 10 raised to power 8 pascals. And then we can now say Young's modulus. Young's modulus is a stress over strain, which implies that we can be able to work out strain from the formula. Strain is equals to Young's modulus. Strain is equals to Young's modulus. Strain is equals to stress over the value of Young's modulus. So, working it out, we are going to get our strain equivalent to 9.47 times 10 raised to power, let's see, the power 4. Yeah, so now using the strain that we have and the original length that we were given 0.84, we can be able to work out the delta x. So you can see delta x over L is equals to strain, but already we have the strain. So we can be able to say delta x is strain times the length, original length of the part that we were told. And that is going to translate to 0.8. Working it out, we're going to get 0.7. Let me see. No, in meters is going to be 7.96 times 10 raised to power 4 meters, but you can now convert that to millimeters. We can convert this to millimeters by dividing by 1000, which translates to 0.79 millimeters. So we can now see that 0.796 millimeters is more than 0.6. Then we can see now the material, the part is not suitable. It's not suitable because 0.796 millimeters is greater than 0.6 millimeters. So meaning that it's not suitable. It's not suitable. Not suitable. Not suitable. Since it compresses more than 0.60 millimeters. A student carries out an experiment to determine the Young's modulus of copper She uses the apparatus below to observe the position of a marker as a copper wire extends under increasing applied loads. We are supposed to describe how the diameter of a wire will have been determined. Remember, diameter of a wire can be determined using the micrometer screw gauge. But in this question, we are supposed to describe. So meaning we are going to measure the diameter in different orientation, in different positions along that wire, and then we get different values, of which we are going to add them, divide by the number of values that we have taken, meaning we work out the mean or the average of the data taken for accuracy. When you are told to describe, that's what you are supposed to do. So we were supposed to state the instrument. First, we were supposed to state the instrument of measurement, and we are going to say using a micrometer screw gauge. Then we are going to explain further and say measure the diameter in different sections and in different position and different orientation along the wire. Thereafter, we shall find the mean average, the mean value of the diameter for accuracy. Still, we have another question here whereby we are told the student calculated the extension of the copper wire for each applied load, and she then plotted a graph against extension. Right, so we are supposed to determine the value of the Young's modulus of copper if the original length of copper was 2.4 meters, yeah, 2.4 meters, and also we were given the diameter there. But for us to do that, we know that the diameter of copper is 2.3 times 10 to the power negative 4 meters. So the first thing that we ought to do is what? Is to work out the gradient of the straight section of this graph, so that we can be able to work out the spring constant or Now, first, we are going to work out the area of the cross section of the wire, and then using the information, remember, the diameter was given there, but for you to work out area, you need the radius. So that's why we are dividing by 2. Working out, we are going to get our value as 2 meters. All right, so next we are going to work out the gradient using the straight section so that we can be able to work out the constant of proportionality, the section where the graph is straight. But if it was a spring, you were to say we are working out the spring constant. But in this case, we are using a wire, we say we are finding the constant of proportionality in that case. So the gradient is going to be that. So our gradient is actually going to be what? 6.5 divided by 2 times 10, 2.9 times 10 raised to the power negative 3. The gradient is going to be in Newton per meters, in Newton per meter. So meaning you have the force per a given force that extend this wire in 1 meter. The constant of proportionality that we have obtained is telling us if you apply a force of 2.2 times 10 raised to the power 3 Newton, it is going to extend this wire by 1 meter. So extension is 1 meter. Then we can now be able to use this information in order to work out what? In order to work out the Young's modulus. So this is what that constant of proportionality is telling us, that a force of 2.2 times 10 to the power 3 provides an extension of 1 meter. So meaning from this information, we can be able to, since we know even the area, we can be able to work out the stress, and we can also be able to work out strain. We already know the length of the wire, yeah? We know the diameter of the wire, which enabled us to work out the area. We have the force that produces an extension of 1 meter, then we can be able to use this information in order to work out Young's modulus. All right, however, let me just take you a different section. Young's modulus is can also be calculated from okay, this is strain. Strain is going to be that, which is going to be 1 over 2.4 because extension is 1, but the length, original length of the wire was 2.4. Then stress is going to be given as force over area. And we know the force we shall use is 2.2 times 10 raised to power 3. Divide by the area, and the area we have 4.1515. This is 1 here. This is 1 here. Then now we know Young's modulus E is equals to stress over strain. Our stress, we have it as 2.2 times 10 raised to power 3 over 4.15 times 10 raised to power negative 8. Everything divided by the strain, which is 1 over 2.4. So working it out, this is going to reduce to what? This is going to reduce to... Okay, that was just a reminder that Young's modulus is that. Young's modulus is stress over strain. Now let's go down here and try to work out what's the final answer for that. Using our calculator. Yeah, 1.27 times 10 raised to the power 11 pascals. Explain why the sample of wire used in the experiments should be long and thin. Remember, if you have a long wire, it will provide a larger extension over a small force that is applied. If you have a thin wire as well, it will stretch more compared if you are having a thick wire which requires a lot of tensile force for its tensile stress for it to stretch. So basically we are going to base our answers around that. A longer wire allows for a noticeable extension when a force is applied. This makes it easier to measure small changes in length accurately. With a thin wire, a small force is required to attain a noticeable extension, and this ensures the material remains within the elastic limit. Because if you add a large force, the material may go beyond the elastic limit. So we need to be adding small masses. We can be able to monitor the extensions and then later use them in order to come up with a graph. Right. So this aspect is also going to reduce the errors in the experiment with thin and long wire. We notice that the uncertainty of the extension is going to be lower, and then that improves the experiment. That improves the experiment. Right, moving to the next question, can add a statement and say small load can be used if you are using a short antique wire. You need big loads in order to observe some extension, but in this case we can be able to measure and determine different extensions with just small loads. In question number 7, a student carries out an experiment to determine Young's modulus of copper. She added a mass M to to the free end of a sample of copper in the form of a long wire, thin wire, and the corresponding extension delta X was measured. This was repeated for increasing masses. We're supposed to state the meaning of the term Young's modulus. Young's modulus is a ratio between the stress and strain of a material. Is the ratio of stress to strain for a material. Remember, we had mentioned the formula for Young's modulus, and that's where we're getting that definition from. And we also mentioned that the value of Young's modulus determines how stiff a material is. Those materials which have a large value of Young's modulus, they are very, very stiff. They cannot bend easily. Determine the cross-section area of the sample, and we are given different diameters of that samples of different sections. So for you to work out that for accuracy, first we need to work out the mean of the diameters, and then once we have the mean, we can be able to use the mean of the diameter obtained divide by 2 to get what? To get the radius. But now, since we have 4 samples, we are going to divide here by 4, and this is going to translate to 0.234, around 0.234 there. And then we can now go ahead, say area equals to pi d over 2 squared. Then we can be able to substitute the values, and we shall get our area being equivalent to 4.3 times 10 raised to the power negative 8 meter square as the area of the sample. Now, the student plotted a graph of m against extension. She measured the gradient and observed the value of the gradient is 195 kilogram per meter. So here, what you need to understand is that mass is proportional to weight. So it's going to have the same graph if we had plotted a graph of force against extension. So graph of m against extension is the same graph, huh? Because mass and weight are proportional. You need also to remember that weight equals to mass times gravity, so that we can be able to convert that spring, that constant of proportionality, to Newton per meter. Yeah, so that we can be able to convert that. That will be equal to 195 times 9.81, which translates to 12.95 Newton. So we can say the value of the gradient can be written as 1,912.95 Newton per meter. And once we have this, we're supposed to use this information to work out the Young's modulus. So taking the constant of proportionality times the original length, which is 3.5, over the cross-section area, it will give us the Young's modulus. This is something that you need to remember. If there's a relationship between Hooke's law, stress, strain, and the Young's modulus. So if you take the spring constant times the length of the spring divided by the cross-section area, that will give you the Young's modulus of that material. Alternatively, I can also show you that using the constant of proportionality, we'll know, that is method two. We know from the constant of proportionality that a force of 1,912.95 will give us an extension of 1 meter. So we can be able to say, using that information, and then we convert that mass to kg, we shall have this Newton will give us an extension delta x of 1 meter, yeah, from the constant of proportionality. But now, since we know the cross-section area and also we have the length, we can be able to work out the stress of this material using force over area. And our force is stress is equals to 1912.95 divided by the area. We shall get the stress like that. We shall have the stress here. Pascals. Now, using the delta x and the length of 3.5, we can also work out the strain. But remember, Young's modulus is equals to stress over strain. Then we can be able to substitute those values that we have there so that we can be able to work out the Young's modulus. And if you work it out, you are going to get it's the same as 1.6 times 10 raised power 11 pascals, the way we got it on the other end. Now, in the experiment, it was repeated by another student using 2.00 meter length of copper wire. Now, we are told that suggests how the value obtained for the gradient, hence, and hence, the Young's modulus would differ between these two students. Then we need to understand that a shorter wire will give a larger gradient, give a greater gradient, because with a shorter wire, we are going to have a small strain, yeah, because strain is delta x over the original length, but the original length now is going to be the wire is going to be 2, which is going to be shorter. So that's why we are saying a shorter wire will give a greater gradient. However, the Young's modulus is going to be the same because Young's modulus does not depend on the dimensions or does not depend on the length of the piece or what. It's just a property of the material. So long as the materials are the same, then the Young's modulus is going to be the same. So we have another question here whereby an actor is suspended using a harness and a cable which supports this person to hang like that. Now, the force on the cable must not cause the material of the cable to reach its yield point. State what's meant by the point, the yield point of a material. Now, if you look at the stress strain graphs, we have different sections. The first section is A, whereby A is the proportional limit of proportionality. From O to A, the material behave in such a way that stress is proportional to strain. So this is the region whereby we say even the material obeys Hooke's law. So from O to A, the stress is proportional to strain. So you can be able to use that region in order to work out the Young's modulus from the gradient. We have another point B, which is called the elastic limit, or it's called the yield point. This is the point, or this is the maximum stress beyond which an additional stress can cause this material to undergo plastic deformation, meaning the material can be deformed permanently. C is a lower yield point. We have a breaking stress, which is D, which is the maximum stress and a material can be able to withstand, beyond which the material is going to break or fracture. So something else I need to mention here is that you can see D to E if the distance to be from D to E is too short, it means from the maximum force this material can withstand for it to break, if the distance between E and D is small, it means this material is brittle. It can easily break once you've exceeded, when once you exceed slightly beyond the breaking stress, yeah, which is the ultimate breaking stress. So we have also other materials which I call ductile materials, which means that even if you apply a force, they can extend without breaking for a longer period of time. So for ductile materials, the distance between D and E is going to be, should be very, very long. All D and E will be much far apart. For brittle, D and E are very close. But D, we have said, is the maximum force or stress a material can withstand before breaking. Now, state what's meant by the yield point of a material. We have mentioned that, so we can now say yield point is the point B, or the yield point, let's try to give a precise definition there. Stress value beyond which the cable undergoes a sudden plastic deformation. Undergoes a sudden plastic deformation. In part B, we are told the cable and harness are used to accelerate the actor vertically off the ground. Explain why the forces acting on the actor causes him to accelerate upwards. So remember, an object will only accelerate if there is a resultant force. That's according to Newton's second law of motion. So this force tension is going to cause this person to accelerate because the tension force on the cable is acting upward and is actually greater than the weight of the actor. Now then it means that since the tension is greater than the weight, then it means there is a resultant force, and this resultant force is going to be acting upward, which will make the person to accelerate upward. Object will only accelerate if there is a resultant force, and they will accelerate towards where the resultant force is acting. We move to Roman 2. The actor has a mass of 77 kg and is lifted vertically from the ground with an acceleration of 2.1 meter per second square. Show that the tension in the cable is about 920 newtons. So how are we going to go about this? We know that resultant force is going to be tension minus the weight of the actor, so we can also work out the resultant force using the formula force equals to ma, mass times acceleration. So we can be able to use the mass that we were given and also the acceleration that was given, work out the resultant force. Now we also need to use the formula weight equals to mg, which means that we can be able to work out the weight of this person, which is going to translate to 755.4 newtons. Then now we can be able to use this formula and try to rearrange it in order to find the tension force. So tension is going to be 161.7 plus 755.4 newton. So we add the two. Tension is approximately 917.1 newton, which is approximately 920 newton, as it was mentioned there. To make sure the actor is safe, the stress in the cable must be less than 15% of the yield point stress. We are told that the cable has a yield stress of 2.5. We are told that the cable has a yield point stress of 2.5 times 10 raised to power 8 pascals, and the diameter is 7.6 times 10 raised to power negative 3 meters. Deduce whether this is safe to lift the actor with a duration of 2.1. Now, to work out this question, what we are going to do first is to work out the stress of the cable. And of course, for us to work out stress, we need to know the cross-section area. So let us start by writing the formula. Stress of the cable. Is force over the cross section area, but area is going to be pi over times d over 2 squared, which will mean that we can be able to always check whether the diameter is given in meters so that you can be able to get correct, because if you don't convert the units to meters, you're gonna get it wrong somewhere. So working out the stress, we can be able to find our value as what? Do we have the force? We have the force, tension force, which was 917 divided by the cross section area. So we get the stress being equivalent to that. Now we have gotten our stress being equivalent to 2.02 times 10 raised to power 7 pascals. So we want to know, we are told that the stress of the cable must be less than 15% of the yield point stress, and the yield point stress was given as 2.5 times 10 raised to power 8. So we're going to find the percentage of this in comparison with the yield point stress. So I can say, now using that, divide by the yield point stress times 100. This translate to 8.08%, and this is actually less than 15%, so which means that is still suitable, is still safe. Yeah, it's still safe with that acceleration, still safe for that acceleration. We have part C. We have part C, whereby we are told that the original cable is replaced with a new cable made from a different material. This material has a lower Young's modulus than the material used to make the original cable. The new cable is the same length as the original cable but has a greater diameter. This breaking stress is the same for both cables. Explain how the work done to break the new cable is different from the work done to break the original cable. Assume both materials obey Hooke's law up to the breaking point.